Assalamualaikum. Today I'm going to talk about potentiometry. So metry is the measurement of potential difference. So at the end of this topic, you should be able to describe the principle of potentiometry and its application in potentiometric titration methods. So there are three titration will be discussed. One is acid-based, one is redox and precipitation. Okay, next, you have seen this before, the flowchart of electroanalytical methods available in order to do analysis. One is bulk method, which is conductometry. Another method is interfacial method. So under interfacial method, there is the potentiometry. So today, I'm going to talk about this. So it's located under interfacial methods. And it's divided into two for interfacial. So one is static, which does not involve current, which I or current is zero. So under this static method, there is a potentiometry. So the application of potentiometry is in the potentiometric titration. Next, it's about potentiometry. We focus only on potentiometry. So potentiometry refers to the use of potential difference, delta E, to determine the concentration of analytes. So, for this potentiometry, it only uses two electrode potential state. Okay, so just two potential state. So, one, there is indicator electrode. So, another one is reference electrode. Okay, so this E cell, so delta E will be measured based on the E indicator without with E reference. Okay, so you can determine what is inside this, probably the metal cation or an ion, okay, in this electrolyte. So based on measurement of the delta E between indicator electrode, okay, this value between reference and the indicator electrode or test system. So it will produce E cell. So this is delta E. Okay, the difference with between this at the interfacial and the reference will produce, will rise the cell potential. If one half fraction is known and held constant, this is refer to reference electrode. You must know the value of RE. For example, if you use silver chloride, so the value is constant 0.195 volt. Okay, so you can determine the concentration of unknown or analyte on the other side of the cell, okay, or system. So the measurement of this potentiometry is done or carried out at equilibrium. Okay, so at here is equivalent to the reaction at the reference. It at equilibrium. Okay, the measured voltage or E cell is related to the activity or concentration of the species in the solution. Yeah. Okay, using is based on or rely on Nernst equation. Okay, so to determine the unknown, the concentration of unknown, so you must use Nernst equation. So this is E cell or the E different, delta E, equals to E indicator and deduct with E reference. So in this E indicator, it contains the unknown. Okay, we look at that later. The most common and familiar use of potentiometry is in pH meter as well as in the titration, potentiometric titration. Okay, it only uses two electrode system, which consists of reference electrode and indicator or indicating electrode. Alright, so next, its base is on this two electrode. One is reference. So the reference dot must be held constant and it must be stable and reproducible. The value For example, SHE, the value is 0 volt. Okay, you must make sure the value, the voltage is held constant and it must be reproducible. For SCE, the value is 0.241 volt. For silver chloride, as I said earlier, 0.195 volt. Okay, so every time you repeat the analysis on different days, you must check the value of reference must be constant. And the value also, the analysis you have repeated must be reproducible. Okay, next electrode is the indicator or indicating, so also known as working electrode. This electrode must contain the solution of interest. Okay, you are going to determine the unknown, okay, the electrolyte or the analyte in this solution. So it must be specific, selective of the species of interest, and very rapid response. That is a characteristic of being the indicator electrode. Okay, must be specific, selective to that species of interest, and also must be rapid. The response must be rapid, must be fast analysis. For example, simple metal electrode and membrane electrode. This is in pH meter, membrane electrode. Okay, next, you look at the simple metal electrode. A bare metal in contact with solute in its cation. Okay, so we focus on indicator electrode. Okay, so for potentiometry, just need two only electrode. Okay, one is reference, another one is indicator electrode. Okay, so here is the indicator electrode. So for example, you have metal. This is the indicator electrode. So in this solution contain the ion for that metal. For example, silver solid as the indicator electrode. So you want to measure the amount of silver ion in the solution. This is unknown. Okay, this silver in the solution will reduce by accepting one electron. Okay, reaction at the indicator electrode is this one. Okay, so this is silver, will accept one electron and will reduce on the metal, the work indicator electrode, which is the same element as the ion, cation in the solution, which is silver. Okay, so this reduction will be carried out on the indicator electrode. So this E indicator, so this is the Nernst equation for E indicator. Okay, so look at this. Okay, you must calculate the E indicator. So this is the, what is the reaction, the standard. Okay, you can check from the table. For silver reaction, E standard is 0.80 volt. Okay, so this one, this value. So this is all Nernst equation. What is N? N is 1 electron. Then this is the silver ion. Okay, silver ion will affect the E indicator. Okay, so then you simplify. So at the end, you will get this. Okay, so this one represent the E indicator. So next, you will substitute into this formula. So this E cell will be determined through experiment. This E cell or delta E. Okay, this cell will be determined by experiment. So this reference, you know what type of reference electrode you use. For example, SCE, okay, is used in this case. The value is 0.241 or 240. Okay, this is the E indicator. Okay, so you know this through experiment. You know what type of reference you use, and you will determine PAG or the concentration of silver ion. So PAG, okay, still missing. So the rest you know. Okay, so you will convert to AG. Okay, similar to pH. pH will determine the concentration of hydrogen ion. So this is how you can determine the unknown, the concentration of, for example, silver ion in this solution using potential matrix by measuring the potential difference between the two electrodes, reference and indicator electrode. So look at the application of the potential matrix is in potential matrix titration. First, about acid-base titration. Okay, so potential E, okay, of the cell including pH electrode and reference electrode, which is directly proportional to pH. Okay, so E proportional to pH, okay, based on Nernst equation, will be plotted against volume of tetrad. Okay, for example, you have in the titration, you need a must have a tetrad. Okay, so then you have two electrodes. Okay, so one is reference, another one is indicator electrode. Okay, for example, in this is unknown, the solution is unknown. For example, you have to determine the acidity of the solution of pH, so the tetrad is the opposite, the base, okay, alkaline. So you will titrate the tetrad. This is tetrad. Okay, so OH will meet with the hydrogen ion. So you will plot this graph. Okay, so while titrating, you will see the increase of E. This you can plot either E or you can convert it to pH. E or pH versus the volume of tetrad. In this case, if between alkaline and acid, you will get this shape, the increase of pH with tetrad, the addition of tetrad. If the tetrad is the opposite, not this one, is but acid, and you want to determine the alkalinity of the solution, so you will get the opposite direction. This is volume of OH or H plus, okay, acid added. So this is pH, or also you can plot E, okay, because E is proportional to pH. So you will determine the endpoint. Okay, this is the endpoint. What is the volume here for the reaction between H? Okay, so M H plus V H plus equals to M O H and V O H plus. Okay, so you can determine the concentration of unknown in the solution. For example, the concentration of hydroxide. Here, the concentration of acid. Okay, you will determine by measuring the endpoint, the volume at endpoint of that between the reaction between acid and base. That is the titration of acid and base. Next application is the precipitation titration. Okay, look at this. Okay, it is possible to titrate a solution containing chloride. So now you want to determine halide ions. Okay, for example, you must have two electrodes. Okay, the conventional volumetric analysis, you use the chemical reaction. Okay, so the tetrad and also the volumetric aluminium flux, and you titrate and you must put indicator. Okay, so the one is, for example, here. So you must, this contain chloride. So in the burette, have silver ion. So but you must add phenolphthalein, for example, or bromothymol indicator. Okay, then you just shake the aluminium flux. Okay, to see the difference in color. So this is the volumetric analysis. Okay, the problem with this, probably you can, the colorblind people, you cannot check what is the accurate color change when you titrate between hydroxide and acid, or silver and chloride, the precipitate form here, silver chloride. But for potentiometry, it's good about this, you can plot. Okay, you can know the endpoint by plotting E versus volume of tetrad. One more thing, you can do a simultaneous analysis. For example, here, there are three ions present, halide ions, so you can do it in one shot, one experiment. Okay, because it's based on the solubility product of the silver compounds, okay, at different potential. Okay, for example, the easiest in this case is silver, the formation of silver iodide, followed with silver bromide and silver chloride. So then you can determine the endpoint for each, okay, formation of the compound, silver compounds. Okay, so look at this. Okay, so this is the precipitation titration. Okay, so in this cell or in this glass beaker contains these three halide ions, iodide, bromide, and chloride. So in this silver ion, this is known. Okay, for example, 0.1 molar silver ion. Okay, in the burette. So this is called titrant. So you can start to add silver ion, and then you will plot this potentiometric titration graph. Okay, so as I said earlier, this is silver ion iodide followed with silver bromide, the easier, more easier than the formation of silver chloride. Okay, based on these three, okay, the solubility product, the formation of precipitate, this is the solid compound will be deposited at the bottom of the container. Okay, so you will plot E versus volume of titrant. What is the titrant? Silver ion. So you know the concentration because you prepare the silver nitrate. And also the volume will be determined once you see this plot. You know the endpoint for each compound form. Okay, so the drastic jump of the potential once drop of this titrant added. So we'll see from one potential it jump to another potential. So in between there is the endpoint at the middle of this drastic potential difference. Here is the endpoint for each compound. So you will determine the iodide ion present in the solution as well as bromine and chloride. Based on this graph, you can determine volume. This volume, all these three will be determined earlier. Okay, no, this is known concentration of silver ion, and this is through experiment. Okay, and this is the initial concentration volume of chloride in this one, for example 25 ml, okay, of test solution. So at the end, still missing is the concentration. You can calculate, do this calculation, you will determine the concentration of chloride, bromide, as well as iodide present based on the endpoint V, the final V for this reaction. Okay, last one is about redox titration. Okay, for example, the titration between cerium 4 and ferrum 2. Okay, so again, you need two electrodes. So one is reference, another one is indicator electrode. For titration, you need this set, the titration set. Okay, so this is V. Okay, so this is what is the titration between cerium 4? This is cerium 4. Okay, in this is the analyte or unknown solution, you are going to determine what is the concentration of ferrum 2. So you will put cerium 4 at simple into this solution. So this is the overall reaction. Cerium 4 is the titrant, will meet this, will react with ferrum 2 as the analyte, and will do the redox reaction. Cerium 4 will reduce to cerium 3, ferrum 2 will oxidize to ferrum 3. So this is the oxidizing agent, so this is reducing agent. Okay, so through this titration, it involves two what you call that area. Okay, look at this. So these two area, this is before, this is endpoint. The drastic jump of potential, this is the endpoint. Okay, this is what we want to determine. Okay, to calculate the concentration of ferrum 2, the unknown. Okay, this is before endpoint, this is endpoint, this area is before. Okay, so this is after, this area is after. Okay, so this area is before. So what is dominant before endpoint, okay, is the reaction between ferrum 2 to ferrum 3. Okay, because once you add cerium 4 into this solution, ferrum 2 will form ferrum 3, will oxidize. Okay, cerium 4 will reduce to cerium 3. Okay, so once it meet or reach endpoint, okay, endpoint, there is no more, there is ferrum 2 is completely oxidized to ferrum 3. Okay, at endpoint. So after endpoint, only cerium 3 present, and cerium 4 it keep on issuing or adding into the beaker, and also ferrum 3 already form here. Okay, but ferrum 2, there is no more ferrum 3 here. Here only 3 ion present. Cerium 3 is already formed here through the before endpoint titration. Cerium 4 keep on adding, okay, through titration. Ferrum 3 is already formed here. Okay, this 3. So this, the after endpoint, the only 2 electrochemical reaction is dominant, the formation of cerium 3 to cerium 4. There is no couple same ferrum 3. Here only 3 ion species present, ferrum 2, ferrum 3 who just form, and also cerium 3. Okay, so only these two couple can be used to do the calculation here before. Okay, between this and this, so you can use T as the amount of volume before endpoint. This is endpoint. This is T before endpoint. But this is the E formal potential for ferrum 2 and ferrum 3. After endpoint, only 3 ion. There is no more ferrum 2. Only 3 ion present, which is, as I said, cerium 3, cerium 4, and ferrum 3. Okay, but only these two will involve in the calculation. Okay, there is no couple about this. Okay, so this you can get from the experiment or from the table. Okay, so this is T prime, the T after, okay, where you stop, and this is the endpoint. Okay, the volume of endpoint. So you can use this next equation to find the missing, either the E cell or the volume. So you can determine the formal potential of between these two couple. Okay, the formula is to find the E, the T, okay, the endpoint. This is this value. This value, you just check when the endpoint over two, half of endpoint. Okay, for this one, between these two is 2 times endpoint. Okay, for example here, okay, this is the okay, the potential. This is the potential when endpoint, half of the endpoint for the starting of the at equilibrium. So this one, okay, this value exactly in the table, okay, between cerium 3 and cerium 4 is double of the endpoint, 2 times endpoint. For example, this is 25 mL, so endpoint it should be located at 50 mL. Okay, at volume of 50 mL, you will find the E formal for these two couple. For this one, 12.5 mL. Okay, you check the volume 12.5 mL. So this is the E formal for theorem 2 and theorem 3. Okay, I hope you understand this about the redox reaction, redox titration. Okay, thank you.